So Philip Sidney is one of the most celebrated poets in the Elizabethan time period, and this is a fact that you can note if in your own preparation of the UGC NET, and that would be he wrote his famous poem Astrophil and Stella based on Penelope Devereux, and the Stella, or the character of Stella, is actually based upon this person right here. And most of his writing appeared after his lifetime, and I think we all know, and it's probably common knowledge, that Philip Sidney was first and foremost a very good poet, and only because of the efforts made by Stephen Gosson to actually dedicate his School of Abuse, the work that automatically tarnished the reputation of poetry. And it was quite fascinating to know that Stephen Gosson actually dedicated his School of Abuse to, directly to Philip Sidney. So, long story short, Philip Sidney actually received this particular dedication in a much more serious sense, and he began writing the Apology for Poetry or Defense of Poesy around 1580. But he actually did not get to publish his own work, because this is actually a work that was published after his time. Now we will take a look at all his key concepts. So Sidney wrote his famous treatise as a reply to Stephen Gosson's School of Abuse, and it was only published in 1595. And he states that poetry in his own time period, for instance in the Elizabethan era, was losing its grip with regard to quality and consistency, because many people, they generally deem the period that had preceded the Elizabethan era to be the barren period. As students who have enough knowledge in the history of English literature, you would also automatically understand how, after the departure of Chaucer from the literary scene, there was this century of barrenness where no proper work of literature was found in English, in England especially, because there were these Scottish contemporaries who were trying to make efforts in order to build a literature of poetry. But on the whole, English poetry was reaching a certain downfall after Chaucer's demise. So, well, this period can be considered as one of confusion, and at the same time one of practical difficulty, because English poets in general had the capacity to versify, had the capacity to handle meter and rhyme, but the language that they had been applying all these different devices was constantly changing. So the decades that precede this particular era can be roughly deemed as the modern period, and the modern period in English literature is one of so many different transformations with regard to the vowel shift, and at the same time the addition of different words from both Latin and French into the English language. Since having all these difficulties considered, Philip Sidney made this practical comment that poetry in his time period had generally become the laughing stock of children. So he manages to make an apology for poetry being in such a sorry state, and in a way, or this was his intention, and his intention was to give a fitting reply to all the accusations that were made by Stephen Gosson. So Sidney hails poets as the fathers in learning. So he was the first person to admit this fact, that poets were generally first and foremost teachers, and he accuses both Plato and Herodotus for being less appreciative of poetry because they had to attain fame. And this was the accusation that is made by Philip Sidney himself, that Plato hated poetry only in order to make himself popular. So everyone has their own opinion, and this is a very stark comment on Plato, because here Philip Sidney is only focused upon bringing out the greatness of poetry. And this is a repeated question that has been asked in the UGC NET, so please pay attention to it. So the Romans called poetry as the poet as the Vates, and the Greeks called the poet as the Maker, and this has been often been quoted or often been scrutinized as a question with regard to the UGC NET. the poet has the capacity to do to to outdo nature due to his imaginative power. And we have seen certain movements in literary criticism in the previous age where, as I had mentioned, we had so many different streams of literary interpretation. One would be the purely philosophical one, and another would be the scholastic one. And the theologians as well as the philosophers were trying to make middle ground with regard to their different philosophical as well as scholastic backgrounds. Here you see a very secular way of putting poetry or interpreting poetry in general, because here we see how poetry needs to be aesthetic and at the same time how it needs to be instructive of society. Sydney perhaps defines three kinds of poetry. Here we see all these different schools or all these different movements of literary criticism merging into one, because he automatically brings out all these different kinds of poets who have been scrutinized by the philosophers and scholars of the previous generation. Because if you happen to look at the Psalms, they are categorized as religious poetry. So religious poetry have always been the focus of study for all these theologians that we saw in the previous class. Now we have the philosophical poets, and philosophical poets are often the first kind of poets that have been taken into consideration with regard to literary criticism. And then we have the right poets. So here, when Sydney defines the right poets, he is automatically making a remark towards who would be very much secular in their approach towards focusing on a subject. The right poet will not focus on any particular subject, but he has everything under the sky to discuss about. He claimed, this is perhaps one of the most important quotations that you can take from Sydney's Apology for Poetry, and that would be, "It is not rhyming and versing that maketh a poet. It is feigning notable images of virtues, vices, and what else with that delightful teaching which must be the right describing note to know a poet by." So he simply puts out, he simply claims that a poet should be remembered for the fact that he was able to put into verse all those different imageries, all those beautiful things present in the existing world, and how he was also able to instruct people through his poetry. So if we happen to consider all the different ideas that were propagated in the previous generation, you would understand how from the time of Plato there was this undeniable notion that the world that we exist in was a mere copy of something that was far beyond our capacity to understand, and that would be the world of ideas and forms. You saw Plato adhering to the same concept, and at the same time you saw his disciple Aristotle also, and we had Plotinus, who automatically instigated the Neoplatonistic view, where all these different scholars, they tended to focus upon a world that was not existing here. But here in this particular work, Philip Sidney clearly describes how the notion of describing the existing world is of much more prominent importance than going into the speciality or the importance of other worlds that is not exactly present here. So Sidney tells that the object of learning is to attempt virtuous deeds. So this is perhaps a very important point where Sidney actually compares the poet with the philosopher as well as the historian. So there was this particular question in the UGC net at one point of time, where a question was asked as to which of the people or which of the different kinds of figures that Philip Sidney was making a comparison between poets, and as you can see here, Philip Sidney is making a comparison between the poet, the philosopher, and the historian. So please make sure to remember that. And here he compares both the philosopher and the historian at the same time in order to elevate the status of the poet, because here he contrives the notion that the philosopher can only teach all the different virtues and all the different qualities that a man should have, but he will not have the examples or the enough examples sufficient enough to validate all those different claims. A historian is quite the opposite of that. He manages to have all these different examples about prominent historical figures, but he will not be able to have the capacity to document all their different virtues and vices. But the poet is the only person who has the capacity to do both of that. He can cite examples, and at the same time he could very well define what is vice and what is virtue. Then the poet is the only person, according to Sidney, who has the capacity to move the people or move the reader through their words. For instance, he has this another important quotation where he tells the winning of the mind from wickedness to virtue. This is perhaps how Sidney sees the purpose of a poet. He should be able to move people from the evil part of their own self in order to bring out what would be the best part of themselves. So another important statement that Sidney makes is that the poet actually never, because this has been always a very prominent claim that has been, a prominent accusation that has been made on the poet, that he often lies. So this is in part true, because we had seen that one critic or one scholar very blatantly told that the poet often lies because the truth is often boring. Here Sidney often manages to justify this notion by telling that a poet or a scholar need, the poet is often the least person you find making false claims, because and this is a very archaic joke, or a very worn out joke that has been passed in every class. When you consider introducing students to the history of the 16th century, because people always had the assumption in that point of time that people should not travel that farther into the sea, because people thought that the world was flat, and when you travel so far into the ocean, you would automatically manage to fall down from the earth, and that was the end. But these scientists, or these even if you take science for that matter, there was a time when people told that there were only 9 planets and there were no other planets to count exactly, and later on they managed to identify that there are more planets and more galaxies. So if we compare the scientist or the person who is well versed in all the different sciences like physics or biology or anything for that matter, he would be the one who is making all these different claims as facts, and with time those facts can also be found to be untrue, and at the same time he will be finding himself redefining all those different facts that he had claimed as true. But the poet is not of that caliber. The poet never affirms anything. He does not affirm the fact that this is like that, this and this is like that. He does not make a valid claim as something that is cemented. But he only makes assumptions, he only makes hypotheses, and he does not clearly give us a statement that this is true and nothing else can be debated about it. He only presents us those ideas that could be further debated and further be analyzed by the reader themselves. So he also claims that it is only man, this has been a very important point that has been noted by Sidney, and that would be how Plato at one point of time decided to banish poets because he thought that poetry was actually marring the well-formed minds of the people. But here Sidney claims that it is not exactly poetry that corrupts man, but actually it's man that corrupts poetry. It's a very common notion that has been understood that literature in general is a reflection of society. So poetry in that manner is often repeating or reflecting what humanity does and what civilization does, but only at certain crucial times, according to general assumption, is that this process could be reversed. Now it is only a brief fraction of cases where man has been changed or altered by the process of poetry, but in most cases it is only man that corrupts the aspect of poetry. So Sidney makes it clear that Plato did not banish all poets as a whole, but only those poets who managed to degrade the value or degrade the respect that was clearly required of gods. So this could be a very important point to note here, because in his defense of poetry, Sidney manages to praise Troilus and Cresseid, written by Chaucer, some of the lyrics written by Surrey, and the Shepherd's Calendar, more importantly, and Gargoyle. So Sidney also makes it a claim that the current dramatists of his own time period were not actually following the three unities of time, place and action, and at the same time they were trying to intermingle both tragedy and comedy. So this was a very sad commentary that Sidney had to make with regard to the current condition of literature in the Elizabethan time period. So the most important work written by Philip Sidney would be The Defense of Poetry, or An Apology for Poetry, and it was actually published in 1595.